Hello, and welcome to Shabby Pug Yarn Podcast. My name is Emma, and I'm your host. So, welcome to both returning viewers and new viewers that are checking me out. Thank you so much. Today, I am recording alone, so no co-host dogs today. They are out in the living room, sleeping. So, yeah, today I'm on my own. It's the 17th of May today. It's Sunday. Rainy outside, so I hope the lighting won't be too bad. Try to record in the brightest room. So anyways, the big thing today is I need to say a really huge congratulations to Norway today, since the 17th of May is the Norwegian National Day and Constitution Day. It's like the same. So it's today. So all my Norwegian friends are out in their beautiful, beautiful bunads. It's like a folk costume, or what you say, this traditional clothing that you have on big occasions. So today everyone is out on parades, eating good food. Everything is blue, red and white, since it's the colors of the Norwegian flag. I saw that even Google had changed the logo with the Norwegian flag and a little parade family. So I thought it was quite nice. So it's historically the constitution was signed the 17th of May in 1814. So last year they had the 200 years anniversary, so it was quite a big thing. Last year I was out taking a walk with a dog, and I accidentally ran into like the big children's parade they have in the morning, and it was people everywhere, well dressed in these beautiful garments, the bunad they say in Norway. So yeah, they wrote the constitution after the Napoleon Wars, where Norway belonged to Denmark, and they had a big defeat, and then Norway signed the constitution papers to become an own country, so that they won't be belonging to Sweden, which was otherwise would have happened probably. So they made their own constitution and wanted to become an own country 201 years ago. So, yeah. but it's quite funny that hardly any people here say, oh, it's Constitution Day. It's just, they just say, oh, it's 17th of May. So, yeah. Now you got a little bit of history lesson. But I'm learning quite a lot about it, so I think it's quite fun. Since it's raining and I'm quite tired, so as you can see, I'm not wearing any traditional clothing or anything, so I'm staying at home, resting. So I thought it would be a great day to talk with you guys. I have my cup of tea, and I actually have some knitting and spinning, so it's not only a history lesson today. But anyway, congratulations on your big day, Norway. So maybe I should go on to the knitting and spinning and fibery stuff instead. Yeah, for the knitting part, I actually had I have an FO, which have already been delivered. So I will insert a picture here. Of the bobble set, The cute baby cardigan in gray and orange with a blue accent that I have been talking about. I showed it last episode without the buttons, so I have taken a picture of the cardigan with the orange buttons I sewed in, and also the little hat that I made. When in Norwegian they say set, it's like the English set. You have like hat, cardigan, and pants in the pattern, but I only made hat and cardigan. But it was a fun knit, and as I have told you quite a lot of times, I really enjoy knitting with the Abuelita yarns. This was Merino 4-ply, and I really, really adore, or I love knitting with their Merino worsted. It's like a single ply. I have probably shown you my Hjertegenser. I love you genser, I think it's called. Or I love me. I'm not sure. Oh, anyways, I have knitted in the Abuelita Merino worsted. I don't know, blue greenish sweater with gray hearts in the yoke. It's my like my favorite sweater. And I love the like the quality of the yarn. It's pilling quite much, but I'm just removing them, and the sweater looks as new. I'm not sure if this 4-ply pills as much. I don't think so, since it's several strands twisted together. So I am imagining it won't pill as much. But since it's quite merino is a quite short fiber, if I'm not wrong, it's easier to pill than like longer wools or longer fibers. So I have knitted some garments in this 4-ply yarn, but I haven't been using anything of it, so I will have to do like quality testing, but I really enjoy the feeling when I knit with it and the fabric I get, and also after washing. I'm a quite crazy person. I have like a wool program on my washing machine, so I mostly since I'm quite busy. I wash my knitted garments in the wool program. They have like a special wool washing thing here in Norway, so that's very gentle to wool garments, and it has been working out great. I use it for, I know that almost all my like in the dyer yarns, they say, oh, hand wash cold. But I don't have the time to hand wash cold. So I take the washing program for wool. I have both in 30 and 40 degrees Celsius. So I often use the 30 degrees with this wool washing thing. So it works out really great. Anyways, so the bobble set is finished. I have no other finished objects this week, but I have been knitting quite a lot. I have some new cast ons, so maybe I should show you one of the cast ons first. This is going to be a sock. I can take my plastic thing. See if I can. Should have done this before I started podcasting, if I had been thinking about it. Let's see if it fits. So, now you get to see a little bit more of it. My fiance. He really enjoys live role playing. And he's going away for a week in June to Sweden, quite close to where I'm from. And they are going to have like 1 week of live role playing reenactment, where they dress up as like some close to medieval soldier clothing. I don't know the English word for it, but it's they are called Landsknecht in Swedish. They have this like really big wool hats with feathers and big like a lot of fabric in spirals on their arms. It's totally crazy and crazy colors. The more, the better. So 2 years ago, he went to an event. They have like a big event 1 week every other year. So it's 2 or 3 years ago. He had sewn a costume in gray with like magenta colored silk. So the garments are in wool, vadmal. So it's quite thick, a thick, good quality wool. And then they hand sew the costumes with shorts and stuff. And then they have like lining that is sticking out. So you sew like a big arm with wool and cut openings in it, and then you pull out big chunks of lining, so you have like really several meters of fabric in your arms and it's sticking out. It's quite cool. And now he's making a new costume in black, orange, and green, so it's turning out really cool. But anyways, he asked me if I could knit him a pair of white socks to have on the reenactment, because there are pictures in like wooden carvings showing a soldier from medieval times that have above knee high socks. So we looked around in the stash and I said, oh, but I think it needs to be rather quite thick if I'm going to be able to knit like above knee in less than a month. So we found some Icelandic yarn that I have inherited from my grandmother. So the yarn is discontinued since forever, probably. But it's white, just plain white Icelandic wool. So I started at the toe and have knitted and then made a heel and I'm knitting the shaft. So this is the first one. It's about halfway up his calf at the moment. So, yeah. Oh, this is 1.5 skein of the yarn. And here's how the yarn looks. See if I can get rid of the glare. So, yeah. I have some time to finish this and make another one. So, but I have to probably prioritize knitting on these so they will be done. The plan is that I will knit above the knee and then make a row with yarn overs or something, because he needs holes to have to tie up with some. I don't know if he's going to use ribbon or something, but it's something to tie it so it stays up above the knee. But that's a new custom that I have knitted for like almost a week. And then I can take one of my ongoing that you have seen before, the Live Long and Prosper socks. Now you can see how the patterning is turning out, or the striping, I should say. So it's black, blue, gold, blue, gold, blue, black. So this is also for my fiancé, but this is on 2.25 mm needles. I'm not sure if that's zeros in US size maybe. I'm really enjoying how the fabric turns out. Quite dense. I made them on 72 stitches and I'm a little bit worried that it will be a little bit too big. But I'm planning to knit a little bit more and then try it out, and otherwise I will have to rip them all out. Since it's quite thin needles, it takes quite a lot of time. So yeah, I have knitted some on them and I will try them on my fiancé and then see if I will rip them out and start over or if I can continue. I think I will have to make a little sneeze. Maybe, it will see. Yeah. Hot tea. And then I showed you last time my Icelandic sweater. I talked quite a lot, I think, about the yarn. Flötulupi. The unspun or loosely spun singles. That you can use either as a single or use it with two strands or three strands or whatever, depending on how thick yarn you want. The sweater is called Vetu, and I have made really lots of progress because this have been a really fun knit. The reason why I have been knitting on it so much is that I discovered I have missed like a whole season of Criminal Minds, one of my favorite series to watch. So when I have watched all the Game of Thrones episodes that were up, I was like, oh, what I'm going to watch now? I have a whole week until the next episode is up. And then I was looking around and, oh, I have missed one season. So season 10 of Criminal Minds. So I had like, I have 23 episodes and I have watched half of it, maybe. So last time, let's see, there you have my little dinosaur. So I have made, last time I showed you, I have made the ribbing and started the button patterning. And now it looks like this. So this is 10 repeats of the lace patterning, or what you call it. Ooh, drop the stitch. So I have made 10 repeats and my marker, and I'm supposed to knit 11 repeats before. Oh, I must beat them up, sorry. Yeah, so I have to knit 11 repeats before starting on the sleeves and then connect them to this body. It looks a little bit grey on the screen, but the color is more like an oatmeal color. I don't know if you will see it differently than I do, but yeah. So this is turning out really great. It's a quite rough yarn, but I really enjoy it. I love knitting with it, so. But unfortunately I haven't been able to knit so much on it since I had to knit the socks. But this is no rush, since I want to be able to like knitted Icelandic sweaters you don't use in the summer. So it's no rush. But I'm quite pleased that I have knitted all the way up here since you saw it last time. And I must make it like this. And the yarn came in cakes, which I talked about last time, with this loosely spun threads. They break really easily. But it's a real pleasure to knit with. So, here, my last knitting project. I have had like a cast on crazy again. The lovely Kemper of Young Yarn podcast, Raybot on Instagram and Ravelry, released a pattern 2 weeks ago, maybe, something about like that, 2.5 maybe, for a sock, so I couldn't resist. So here is the progress on my first sock. So it's knitted cuff down, and in the pattern she explains how to knit an after fault heel, but also writes that in the sampler sock on the picture, she have made a fish lips kiss heel. So depending on if you're having like a highly striping or something, you should do an after fault. But if you have a semi-solid, maybe it's good to have fish lips. And I have wanted to try the fish lips kiss heel for a really long time. Everyone is talking about it, and I really wanted to try, and I was really impressed actually on how it turned out. I have tried it on my foot and it seems to fit quite good. I know that quite a lot of people hate or really tries to avoid the heel flap and gusset, and I don't have any problems with it. I think that the heel flap has like a really nice fit, since I have quite a high instep, so that's the almost always the biggest problem for me. But the fish lips seems to work out quite well. I will give you more of a saying when I have tried them on my foot properly. But like all the first years, I only knit the heel flap and gusset. That's the way I learned to knit socks. So I didn't know it was hard or boring, so I have just been knitting them. That's one of the positive things, I think, that when I started knitting, I couldn't... There was never anyone there to tell me, oh, this is hard, so, or anything, so I trust the description, and it worked out great, so... But I always thought that like the heel flap and gusset was a little bit of a magic. You just turn and turn and turn and then you have a heel. And it felt a little bit like that with this one too. I was just knitting and doing short rows. And I really liked the method for short rows in this. And then I turned back and did some other short rows. And there was a heel. And the fish lips kiss heel you can get on Ravelry for like $1, so it's really cheap. And you don't have to be intimidated by the big file you get. You get like a PDF with, I don't know, 20 pages or something, but it was like 2 or 3 pages that describes what you're doing when you're doing the heel. The other is just description of how it works and how to measure where to place it. It's actually really good, so if you haven't tried it, you should do that. One thing I also liked about the pattern for the sock, maybe I should say, it's named Bickerstrat. Not sure of the pronunciation. Whatever. It's from the Netherlands, a street that she lived on, if I'm not wrong. Bickerstrat, anyway. So the pattern is like an eyelet thing on the cuff and down the top of the foot. And what she wrote in the pattern is that she prefers her cuffs to be, or legs to be, quite short. So the pattern worked out really well for me. I only had room for 3 repeats. It was written in the pattern to do like 4 repeats or until, I don't know if it was 4 inches or something. But when I have knitted the ribbing and the 3 repeats, I was already at the correct length. So it fits really well. And the yarn that I'm using is Malabrigo sock in the eggplant colorway. I have never knitted with this before, but I really love it. So So I got this, could be 2 years ago. It's a lovely lady quite close to my hometown who has a little yarn shop in her yard. So I convinced my mother to go there, and we shopped like crazy. So this has been lying in my stash for 2 years, and now I found the perfect pattern for it. I had planned to knit Snape stockings, but I never came around to it. And then when I saw the pattern from Junkyarn, I said, oh, this will be the perfect match. And it really, really is. So yeah, I'm knitting it on DPNs, my cubics. So 2.5 millimeters. So this is the square needles. I think it's quite nice to be able to like switch between having one sock on DPNs and then have one sock on circular magic looping. I don't know why actually, but I think it's, I have a little bit of a different grip on the knitting needles. So when I can change and switch between projects and have a little bit of a different grip in my fingers, I don't get pain in my hands and wrist, since I'm, yeah, in my work days, Monday to Friday, I knit maybe 1.5-2 hours, and then in the weekends, I don't know, maybe I can probably sit and knit for 6 hours, not straight, but I knit for like 1.5-2 hours in the beginning of the day, after I have had breakfast and walk the dogs, and when they go to sleep, for I can knit for 1.5-2 hours, and then I knit some hours in the afternoon, and then I do some other stuff, and then I knit in the evening, so probably 6 hours both Saturday and Sunday, and I never, almost never have pain in my hands. But if I have the same type of needle, like only do magic looping on the same pair of socks for a whole weekend, I get pain in my hands. But if I have DPNs and circulars and metal and cubics in wood, I think it works out much better. I really, really enjoy my cubics. I think they are my favorite 2.5 cubics. That's the thing I use the most, at least. Hey, because I like to knit socks, they're the ones I use most. But, yeah. Anyways, if you haven't got this pattern, you should absolutely should. She's having a knit along with it in her Ravelry group. So you can look for Junkyarn. You will probably find it. It's really, really nice. And I'm planning to knit on these as much as I can. This will probably go to be my lunch knitting at work during next week. So, yeah. I don't know if there was anything more to say on that. Oh, perfect temperature on my tea now. I'm a little bit weird when I'm drinking tea. At least the rest of my family think so. Since in Sweden, and probably in Norway too, almost everyone drinks coffee. And no one in my family drinks coffee. I'm born and raised a tea drinker since childhood. But the rest of the family think I'm quite weird when I'm drinking tea, since I often leave. They are like sippings and sipping and sipping some tea. And I just sit and talk and talk. And when I have the correct temperature for me, I take the whole cup, almost. So they are always joking about me. Oh, is your tea cold yet so you can drink it? But yeah, I don't know. And I really love my cup. I know that some have seen it before. It's a Burman cat and a little mouse on the side. and you can pause tracks on it. Unfortunately, the cat has one broken ear. But I really, really like it. My brother got from the same, I don't know what you say. You say ceramiker in Swedish, the person who makes ceramics. My brother got cups with black cups with dragons on them. So it's one where the dragon is on the edge. The problem is the cups are made for right-handed people. So when I drink, I will have the cat, or in his case, the dragon, on the side, but he is left-handed. So when he turns the cup, he gets the horns of the dragon in his face. So I think it's quite fun. So when I'm visiting and wanting a big cup, I always have to take the one with the dragon on the border, since it's poking his eye if he tries to drink it from it. Yeah. Anyways, I think I'm off track back and forth today. I don't know. I bet that if you don't like it, you can just fast forward, or I don't know. Maybe you like me blabbering around. On the crochet part, I have actually been quite productive. I don't have all the squares with me, but I have been making quite a lot of squares. I think I counted them to 35. I got the lovely package from Frida, Knitting With You, who's also having a podcast, whom I'm going to have a knit along with. I got a big package with scraps, so I haven't woven them in the ends, but I really enjoyed all the beautiful colors. And this one is one of my favorites. Sparkle and rainbow and purple. And some light ones. And some blue. And some purple, of course, and I really, really liked how it turned out. And some green. So I have crocheted perhaps 40 or 50 squares that are loose. And then I saw that Disa, who has Disa's Craftwork podcast, she talked about and showed her big blanket she's working on. And it's all about that she had to make another one for her hobby, because he wanted to have it. And I saw how much progress she had made, and I decided that, oh, I need to actually crochet the squares to my blanket too, because I can't, it's not a blanket if it's just 100 squares lying around. So now I have actually done some progress on my blanket. So now it's 30 squares, 5x6. And some of them are from Frida. So this one out on the end, and the purple one, and the green one, and the blue one, and the red and green. And I think it's some more. Oh yeah, here's one of my favorites. So this one, it's reds and blues and greens. It's quite cool. So this is how far I have gotten. And since I have a lot of squares to crochet to the blanket, I hope it will get bigger and bigger. So I have found that it's really nice to have just a little, like a little ball of yarn and the crochet hook lying like in my pocket in my jacket, because when I get a few minutes waiting for something, like waiting for my coworker to pick me up in the morning, if I'm too early, I can just sit and crochet for a minute or two. If I'm waiting for the bus or waiting for my fiancé outside the store with the dogs, I can just sit in the sun and crochet on the squares, so it's quite calming. And also if I'm getting stressed out or like feeling anxious, I just pick out the crochet hook and the yarn and make some squares. So that's why I produce quite a lot of squares in a week. But since I'm not at home attaching them to the blanket, they are just piling up. So my boyfriend have named them my anxiety squares, since I'm relieving my stress on the squares. It's perhaps true, I don't know. I get calm when I work with my hands and I can focus on not stressing out. I'm easily stressed out about planning. I love to plan and I love to have control of what's happening and when it's happening. But same time, I can overdo it quite a lot. And my fiance is a lot more of, oh yeah, it will work out. And I get crazy and it's like, oh, but I need to know, I need to know, I need to know when and when and when and how and. So it's quite good to have tools to make me more laid back and to relax. So it's better for me and for my health to not stress out about things that I can't control. I don't know about you, maybe you have some good tricks, or do you also do some crafty stuff to relax? Maybe you have some tips for me how to not stress out so much. I try to knit, spin, and crochet to keep sane. Not that bad. It sounds like it's really bad, but you know, when the stressful everyday is catching up with you, it's nice to have something to focus on that will make you relax. Oh, tasty, tasty tea. So yeah, on the spinning part, when I'm saying knitting and spinning, I have been spinning on my Rolex from Knitters Gonna Knit, the Queen of Hearts. I had 16 of these when I started, and I showed you when I had spun up one bobbin. So 8 of them. Now I have been spinning some more and I actually have 3 left. So soon it will be plying time. I don't really remember the fiber content. I will have to check it up. I will probably explain it when I have finished it. But the plan is to spin it thin and ply it 2-ply. And then knit a shawl out of it. I hope. We'll see. But yeah, I have 3 of those left and then I will be finished. It's quite a nice preparation with the Rolex, at least for me. I don't know if it's just for me or for all beginners, but I find it easier to get more even and do longer drafts. Since when I have tried other forms, I often like do the inchworming thing, but also the silk contents help, but you can draw out longer pieces of fiber and get it more even. It's not perfectly even, but it's a lot faster and more even than when I've tried other things. Maybe I just have been sloppy when I have pre-drafted before, but I found that the Rolex helped me a lot. Since my spinning wheel is quite old, it's a little bit tricky. It's one of those really traditional with a double drive band, do you say it? So I have like a string that is tied twice. So one time around the flyer and one time around the bobbin. So it's a bit tricky since I learned to spin on a course where they had like modern both Irish tension and Scottish tension. I don't know if that's the correct term, but they had like breaking on the fly or breaking on the bobbin, like modern versions, and it's a lot easier to control a modern one. But for the time being, I can use the one I got from my grandmother. It's a little bit like it's hard to make it work sometime, and I need to make us better friends, but it's working out quite well. And at least when I spin, I get string, and I will probably hopefully get yarn from it, so in that way it's working. So even if it's not totally straight and stuff, but it's working, so I can practice, and it's okay. And yeah, on the crafty side, I have one thing left. I have made quite a good progress on the Banksy cross stitch. So now the upper body, except for the arm here, the upper body is finished. So I'm going to start with the legs soon. It's quite challenging with the black stitches. So it's daytime work only, so I almost only do crochet in the weekends when I'm at home when it's daylight. But I'm thinking it turns out quite good. So yeah. And the legs are not as dense. With the black, so the legs will probably go quite fast, and then I'm planning to do the arm at the end, because then the colors for the flowers is going to be in this end. So I'm planning to do all the black first, and then do the coloring of this section last. So I save the fun thing to last. So because I know myself, if I'm doing this arm and all the colors, I won't do the legs, because then it will get boring. So I'm motivating myself to do the legs, so I can do all the flower colors on it. Lost. But yeah, it had some progress. And I really like cross stitching, so I will probably do a lot more of this from now on. Yes, so that's all the fibery content for this week. I have almost talked for 45 minutes, so I bet it's a lot of sidetracking things. It's one of the fun things is that when I talk, I have like show notes, that so I can see that I have talked about everything I want to talk about. But when I have talked about things, I cannot really remember what I said. So if I'm sidetracking a lot, I will probably not remember it 10 minutes later. Yeah. Anyways, you can fast forward if you want, or whatever suits your fancy. I have some more points before I'm done today. So in the stash a lot section, I have some nice stuff. The Norwegian company called Sandnes, they release these pattern magazines, maybe you can call them. So I got 4 new ones when I was at my local yarn store the other week. So it's one for knitting in cotton for children. So they have, let's see, they have a picture of all the designs in the back, and then they have like thematic pictures of for the knitting, and in the middle they have like descriptions so you can look it up how to knit it. So one for knitting cute tiny stuff in cotton, and then one for knitting in merino wool for children. So this is for the little bigger ones. So it's the same thing. And then one for knitting in thin. They have Sunless have yarn called merino wool and thin merino wool, and then they make this catalogs or patterning magazines to accompany, so you can check up cute patternings, and I really like this one. So they have a lot of these magazines, and then one that is quite popular is this one. And actually the pattern on the front cover there, I think it's called Clara Dress, so it's quite popular. And I'm planning to knit one. Let's see if I can show you in the inside. If they have any pictures on it. No, it's just the same as in the front. So it has some, I don't know if you can call it lace, but they have some yarn overs to make patterning in the bottom and in the top. Really pretty. And it's knitted up in alpaca silk yarn. So the only fiber stash is three skeins of Sunless alpaca silk. In this, I don't know how to, it looks a little bit too cold in the colorway. It's like somewhere between pink and purple, dusty pink and dusty purple. It looks a little bit too much purple in the picture. Then, I don't know. It's somewhere a dusty pink or dusty purple mix. So it's alpaca and silk. Let's see, it's 70% baby alpaca and 30% mulberry silk. So it's really, really soft. And I have 3 skeins, so I can knit the size 18 months, I think it was. But that will probably be summer knitting or autumn knitting, I'm not sure, because I have some other knittings planned, as you probably know by now. Oh, I hope you don't find it boring when I'm drinking tea, but I get dry. I dry up in my throat, so. And for crafty desires, I'm having quite a bit of Icelandic patterning craziness, because we have confirmed at work that we are going to Iceland this autumn again. So I'm really, really thrilled about it. I went with my boss and a coworker of mine. In 2013, we went for a course. I don't know if you're new, I'm working as a prosthetist, so making prosthetic legs, and I also work with shoes and other stuff, but the prosthetics for legs mostly. And so I went there to have a course on bionic, I don't know how to explain it, but computerized prosthetic knees for those who are amputated in their thigh or even in their hip. they need some kind of knee, prosthetic knee, and it can be purely mechanical, or it can be computerized with like microchips and gyroscopes and stuff. And to work with them, you, it's better if you get like a course and to get certified for it, so you know what you're doing when you're changing things. Then you could, you connect it with a computer to change like how it swings or how it breaks or how it reacts when you're stumbling, because falling with a prosthesis is not good, so you're trying to make it safe, but you need it to work as good as possible. So I went on a course to Iceland because one of the big companies making this high-tech products have their like headquarters on Iceland. So we went there and learned how it worked, and then we got 1 day for sightseeing and touring, and then I bought home a big bag of yarn. I convinced the others that we could drive by the big wool factory on Iceland. It was awesome. And now the prosthetic and orthotics like work group as general is going to have like a huge meeting on Iceland in the end of September, start of October, so that's the weekend. So we're going to have 3 or 4 days on Iceland, and almost all my co-workers will travel with us this time. So they're going to be lectures and a lot of like representing of science and studies and I don't know, maybe workshops, touring in the factory of the company that are on Iceland, and that kind of stuff. So, and therefore I hope that I will be able to go to the wool factory again. I don't know if you're able to like take the bus, because last time we rented a car for the four of us to go. I don't know if any of my co-workers will go or if I have to travel by myself. But I will do my best to go there and get some more Icelandic yarn. And therefore my crafty desire is Icelandic sweaters. I have been watching a lot on Ravelry. So some of the patterns I have been really interested in is one that I looked at already the last time. I'm not sure about the pronunciation, so I will probably butcher everything, but I will put the spelling on the screen too. So Mora, eller Mora maybe, is a nice long sweater with braids and patterning. I will try to find a picture of it. It's one that I want to knit for myself. And the designer is called Gudrun Gunnarsdottir or something like that. So it's a really nice, I don't know what you call the patterning, but the patterning is really beautiful. And then a braid in the main color going down the body. It's really, really pretty. I wanted to knit it already last time I went. And then there is a baby sweater called Loki. By the designer Ragga Eriksdottir, which I know quite a lot of Swedish people have been knitting in the last couple of years. They had a knit along and I was planning to knit it, and then I just didn't. But I want to knit one of those. And also I know that the last time I was going, I found a really cute pattern called Monkey Donkey Apapesa, or something like that. The last one is supposed to be Icelandic, but by Eva Roos. So it's not a traditional Icelandic sweater, but it's a baby or toddler sweater with monkeys. Sorry, that was really, really cute. And then I found a really beautiful, quite simple cardigan. And I will butcher the name quite badly. Riddraud? I don't know. But it's designed by Steinun Birna Gudjonsdottir. But it was a simple, simple cardigan with some flower boarding on the yoke. Really pretty. I know from now when I have used my Riddari, my Icelandic sweater, I have been using it for a year maybe. And I really love to have it when I'm out walking the dogs and stuff. The only thing is the fact that it's a pullover, a regular sweater. So I'm thinking that I want to knit myself an Icelandic sweater, sorry, with a cardigan or something. So with a zipper, I think, and then have pockets so I can have dog candy and stuff. So I'm not sure if I'm going to adjust a pattern there is, or if I'm going to look and see if I can find an Icelandic sweater that I can put in a zipper and have pockets, so I can buy some more yarn. I probably want to knit in the Plateloopi, the unspun one, because I really liked it, or maybe in some more Letloopi. I have some left, so I could probably knit something with it. So yeah, my crafty desires is Icelandic sweaters, high and low. And I will be on the lookout for a cardigan with pockets to knit in Icelandic yarn. And then we come to the last section, which I have named Podcast Love and Announcements. So we can start with the podcast love. I want to send a thank you to Nathan, who has Stockmatician podcast. I mentioned his podcast some episodes ago. I think when he had released episode 2 of his podcast or anything, something like that. And now he gave me a shout out. So thank you so much. I really enjoy your podcast. So, to all my viewers, if you're not watching Stockmatician, you should do that. It's a great podcast. And also, I want to send out a big hello and welcome back to James, who has Dancing Geek podcast. He has been having an hibernation or something for some time, and now he had released a short episode some days ago, and this morning I saw that he had released another longer episode, so I was really glad because it's one of my favorite podcasts. So welcome back if you're watching this one. It's really nice to have your podcast as a company again. And then, lastly, I have some updates for the Hitofude knit-along that I'm going to have with Frida, Knitting With You podcast. So if you're not interested, thank you for watching. And if you're curious about the knit-along, you can stay for another couple of minutes. So if you haven't heard this before, Frida, Knitting With You podcast, and I are having a knit-along for the beautiful, beautiful cardigan, Hitofude, by Hiroko Fukatsu. It's a really nice lace cardigan, open cardigan. But we both wanted a knit, and now we have decided to have a knit along. And I have noticed several of you have commented in my Ravelry group, and some have commented on Instagram. So the plan is to start the 1st of June, so another 2 weeks almost. And we are going to knit the cardigan from the 1st of June to the last of August, so you have 3 months to knit. We will probably have some weekends if possible, but we will always be available in the Chatter thread, which you can find on my podcast group. So if you go to Ravelry and search for Chubby Pug Yarn Podcast, you will find my group. You can there become a member and then write in the Hito Fuji Cal Chatter thread. Post picture of your yarn. I have posted a picture and I have noticed that some people have been writing about wanting to join and what they're planning for. So you can chatter all you want, post pictures of your progress during the knitting. And when you're done, Frida have the finished objects thread. So in my post for this chatter thread, there's a link. So you will come directly to the FO thread in Frida's group. There you can post the picture when you're done with your sweater. And we're splitting it up because we're going to have prize drawings. So for those who have finished their cardigans before the end date, the last of August, we're going to have 3 different prizes. The plan is to having it Japan themed. So first prize that will be drawn from the finished objects thread will be a project bag and knitting markers. I will come with an update with pictures when I get it. So first prize, a project bag and markers. Really pretty, hopefully. And then the second prize will be 2 skeins of a silk yarn called Kito. I will probably have pictures for next episode or something. The third prize will be a pattern of your choice from Hiroko Fukatsu, the designer of the cardigan. So we will have that as a third prize. You can get some other pattern from the same designer to sponsor this designer a little bit extra. And then we will going to have drawings from the chatter thread as well for some small appreciation prizes. So we will draw from maybe halfway through or something, we will draw a prize from the chatter thread as well. So it's important to, or not important, but it's more chances of getting a prize if you're also commenting in the chatter thread as well. So I will get more information for you when we have gotten the pictures of all the prizes and stuff. But you are allowed to make a gauge watch, this watch before 1st of June, so you can start knitting the actual sweater. If you're not doing swatches, you can't start. That's cheating. But cast on for the sweater is the 1st of June. You are allowed to wind up your skeins and do a swatch if you need to, or if you're a good person that washes the swatch, you are allowed to do that before. So you are prepared to cast on. Wash the swatch was trying to say that 10 times. That would be weird. So yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. I haven't skeined up or caked up my skeins or anything yet, since I'm quite full of other knitting things. But anyways, so that was all for the Cal information so far. I hope we will have a good time with it. Otherwise, it will be... I hope I will have quite a calm week next week, so I can record on next Sunday. But I can't make any promises. I figure that I will have quite a stressful week, even though I want to have a relaxing, good week. I will probably have a lot of things to do. It's quite interesting how the workload depends on the season. In a working year, we have quite... Or not, we have a calmer period in the beginning, like January and February, where, I don't know, people are doing other stuff. And then it slowly starts in March and April, when like the snow melts, people are starting to come in to get spring shoes. And then in May, it increases quite a lot, because then people want summer shoes. Walking boots for like walking, hiking and stuff. And then it increases until the vacation in July. Then it's quite calm in, it's calmer in August and maybe September. Then it starts to increase again, because then people want autumn shoes and winter shoes. October, November. And December, it's totally crazy, because everyone wants everything before Christmas. And that's how it goes. So, we have quite a high load of high pressure time now in the end of May. And then we also have like all the regular aids with the prosthetics and things we do, but we work a lot with shoes. And that you can see, like, it's... And most of the people that have shoes also have these special made inserts that you make from the impression of the foot. And that's quite a lot of time. It's time consuming to do. So that's why it's, you get like a high pressure. And then if you're having some new patients with big orthotics or big prosthetic things, that takes quite a lot of time, a lot of visits back and forth. So it's a quite high load this time of the year. But anyways, I hope I will have time to record next weekend, and that I will have some meeting time. When I have a lot of work, I often come home, I eat, we go out with the dogs, and then I go to bed. It's quite sad to say, but I'm one of those people who needs a lot of sleep. So even in my work days, I need at least 8 hours of sleep. So I need to be in bed before 10, so I can sleep 8 hours before I need to go up in the morning. I sleep a lot. And the sunlight helps a lot, so I'm getting better at actually prioritizing having some knitting time in the afternoons when I'm home from work, or when I get home from work. So, but if I don't have so much knitting to show you, I can at least talk to you, because apparently I can slide away to history lessons, explaining how my work works. So talking is not a problem anyways. So I hope you will have a wonderful Sunday. If you're in Norway, hope you will have a lot of tasty cake and nice celebrations. And if you're anywhere else, I hope you will have a lot of nice knitting time. And I will hopefully see you in 1 week. Take care.